I would like to start with thanking Honorable Vice Chancellor Professor Dr. Rajbir Solanki for giving us this platform so that we, as we have talked in these dire circumstances, we are making our best effort to get in with all of us together. Thank you very much, sir. I would request, I would like to make a edit, sir. I am not a social scientist, I am a humanist, and my research domain happens to be digital humanities. So humanities and digital sciences, that's what I actually mean. So I would like to make use of this opportunity to share my ideas and thoughts about it. Thank you very much, sir, that you have allowed us, Department of English, this opportunity. And I must thank Professor Dr. Umed Singh Ji, who is presiding over this session, I assume, if there is not any change, what I was conveyed. It has been a pleasure to work in this Department of English with all the senior most faculties, all the senior most teachers in the department. For the record, I am the junior most, and I am happy to be the most junior in the faculty because I have worthy seniors. They have contributed in making me what I have become or what I'll become. So I seriously appreciate and thank Department of English for giving me this opportunity to have a online session with all of you. And I must thank all the senior professors, teaching and non-teaching family members of CDLU, all research scholars who are here to have this session with me. And with your permission, sir, I would like to start the presentation now. Basically, the presentation is about education and digitalization. And before I start the session, actually, I wanted to share something more with you before I come to this session. I would like to share two slides or two websites that are actually, I have shortlisted to begin this session. This first is a Guardian newspaper website, and this shows that, I hope I am visible to all of you, the screen is visible to me, and this shows that the session ended in DBT. DBT is a university business breakthrough university in Tokyo, and because of social distancing, the convocation could not take place in its normal way. So robots actually were used in place of students, specific students, to take this degree. I hope it is visible to all of you. And the second thing that I want you, I think there is nothing new in it, but still for contextualizing, I would like you, all of you, to have a look at Johns Hopkins University website. I hope all of you have seen some or the other website every day showing this kind of images that are, I hope all of you can see India in this. What I want to bring your knowledge to is that, will it be possible to have this kind of things in our contemporary world if there was no digitalization? And that's where I would like to start with all of you. First, I would like to talk to you that what is this. Before I come to this, I would like to begin with a disclaimer that most of you, I feel, the target audience is consisting of senior professors, professors from all faculties, teachers from all faculties, students, research scholars, non-teaching staff. So I didn't know what is my targeted audience, and it's very tough to focus on one particular aspect of it, because for science, technology, engineering, mathematics, digitalization means one. For commerce, business faculties, it means altogether different. For education, for social sciences, for humanities, it means altogether different. But still, I have tried to manage I've tried to take a generalized view, and at times you might feel that it is an overhead transmission, as they call it, or you might feel that maybe I'm talking a peanut story for your knowledge. So please bear it with me. Let's start with what is digitalization. What does this word, this term digitalization mean? Actually, digitalization is transformation of economy. And economy or life, what I call here, is economy or life, economy as Chanakya used it in his book Arthashastra. Life in general, life in its whole appearance. Digitalization is actually transformation of this life, these tools and technology. Actually, in last 30 years, byte or bit, which is the smallest segment of digital economy, has become central to our understanding. Perhaps somewhere when Aryabhatta discovered his zero, and the zero was me and the other was one. So between me and one, me and other, zero and one, the bit started, and bit made a byte, and from byte we have such a long journey. Digitalization is the transformation of economy from analog to digital. And in my first part of this presentation, I'll be dealing with the history. I'll be talking about how manual labor, which was analog, still analog, it turned to automatic, self-operated, machine-operated, manual, which was first manually and now automated. So the spectrum is, on the one end is the nomadic life, how life started, and one another is this day today, 1st of May 2020, so how it has shifted. Today, we kilobyte, megabyte, gigabyte, terabyte, they are common talk. In our day-to-day discussions, we do talk of this. That today we had a session and the recording was done, and it was around, say, 5 GB of data, and everything has been converted into data. A video, a text, an audio, multimedia, life in general, in its recorded form, has become a data. And that's something serious. We will talk more on this. More and more spheres of life have been controlled by the programmed machine, which are actually operating through bits. Last 30 years have changed a big, big change. And that big, big change has been starting from computerization. Initial start was creating a machine that could do, that could solve, that could do calculations. And today it is doing practically all things of human life. We will come back to it. But before we come to it, it would be better that we understand that what kind of world existed before digitalization. Today we are almost 50% of it, in the midst of it. Maybe if life goes on, if COVID, Corona allows us to live on for another 100 years or something, maybe when somebody looks back at it, 1st of May 2020, maybe he would understand what I'm saying right now, that we are around 50% of blending, 50% of human life is digitalized, 50% of human life is still analog. And we are very fast approaching to a total paradigm shift for digitalization. Actually, to put it in historical terms, an analog economy meant when we were doing things manually or by the machine that were operated manually. If you start looking at human life, it started somewhere in nomadic life of hunting. But even in hunting, we needed things like we needed weapons. We created weapons by stone. Maybe then we discovered iron. Maybe then we discovered other metals. Started finding weapons that could, or other things that could help us in making our life easy. From nomadic life, we moved on to agrarian life. Here, our dependence on objects and tools perhaps aggravated. We moved to make equipment for animal husbandry, for our agriculture products, for our agriculture activities. We created different equipments. And from equipments, from tools, we started creating machines that could be operated, to use. But I think from equipment to machinery, the basic difference was the beginning of industrial age, and that too when we actually discovered steam engine. That's where perhaps the biggest change came. And from steam engine, we now had a machine that was ready to do manual labor, and man could operate it, and his energies were saved from manual energy. It was more intellectual energy. He could create an engine, and the engine was doing things for him. From steam engine, we moved on to diesel engine model, locomotive. From locomotive, we moved on to electricity. It was seen in the form of automobile. People used to carry the carriage. People used to pull the carriage initially, and then came the cars, and then we all understand how we came to nuclear aeroplane, and finally to the nuclear bomb. Personally speaking, I feel that industrial age starts with the beginning of steam engine in 1770s, 1780s, and on 14th of August 1945, when Hiroshima, Nagasaki bombs were dropped on 6th and 9th, and on 15th, Japan came to war seizure. I personally feel that's where life changed to some extent, because that's where industrial age perhaps ended and a post-industrial society started. And this post-industrial society had an important form, and that important form is computer. Once computer was discovered, computer has a long history. 1930s, 40s, 50s, it was all evolving. But its final, I don't know what word I should be using, maybe a public prototype, a prototype where computer became PC when Macintosh and other models came. I think we were touching 1990s at that point of time. But once computer came, it changed everything. It changed all previous discoveries of human life, starting from wheel and maybe to nuclear bomb. Everything got digitalized. And this digitalization is what we are reading today, this upgradation and enriching of human energy, human life, human discovery, is digitalization. So I hope you will understand what I want to say, that this digitalization is different from computerization. Computer is the medium. Computer entered all spheres of life, may it be automobile, may it be communication, may it be teaching. And this process of computerization is digitalization. So digitalization is the bigger term. Computerization, I think, is the medium of it. But I'll leave it for computer scientists to define it further. Not my cup of tea. I'm not the right person, not the expert to speak about it. So some people might confuse it with digitization. The digitization is different than digitalization. Digits were already used in human life. We used to measure kilometers, meters, other weight and spaces were measured through digits. Though, of course, they were all now digitalized. They have been now digitalized. But I hope it will be best to understand that calculator was the first computer, first form of computer. And now we have wonderful prototypes, maybe the Spectrum today stands at a driverless car or something of that sort. Last 30 years have been big. And I feel these last 30 years have been big in the sense that 90s belong to Microsoft, where products like graphic user interface, Windows were created, where people were able to actually communicate with machine. Interface was created. The machine was no more machine. It was not only the source code writer or the machine code writer who could utilize the machine, but an actual end user, a person like you and me, who is not into digital, who is not actually into computational sciences, can actually use it for his day-to-day purposes. So 90s belonged to Microsoft, that gave us Windows and other such things, that it became finally usable to us. But from there, Google took off. 2000 to 2010, I think, is the era of Google. Google gave us the search engine, but more than search engine, or perhaps nothing bigger than search engine, it gave us Google Mail and other big packages that we are today using. Thank God we are discussing this on a Google Meet, which is part of Google Suite, Google Package. From 2010 onwards, I feel that digitalization, computerization has more of a social phase. In the first 5-7 years of the second decade of 21st century, I think Facebook was more important. Socialization, as Sir was also saying, that he's on Facebook and then Twitter and LinkedIn and other things. So finally speaking, last 3-4 years, I think belong to WhatsApp and related social medias, because that's why perhaps Zuckerberg bought WhatsApp. But we will come back to it again. We moved on from analog world to this digitalized world. And I feel the biggest shift was the shift in communication. Communication is something that has always been with man. I feel that man has been controlling this universe, or at least this earth. Right or wrong, I'm not here to discuss. I'm not in position to decide it, whether it was a right way of controlling it or not. But man has been able to control this because man controls communication. He's a wonderful communicator. And that's what has made him excel into this world. And the biggest shift also, I feel, came into communication when this digitalization came. Earlier, we used to have messengers. We used to have letters by post. I hope all of you have seen that. Maybe messengers, you have seen those beautiful film songs where pigeons were given messages and kabutarja kind of thing that you have seen. But those pigeons were messengers, human beings were messengers. Maybe communication, if I'm asked about communication, I would say the first communication should have been an hieroglyph made by a nomadic man in some cave. Some of those pictures in the cave were the first communications by human beings. But then came messengers, then came letters by post. Then technology started coming up. I feel that's where some digital algorithms started coming in. We had telegrams, then we had telephones, and even the journey of telephone. You all know from how Graham Bell had a wire laid to his friend's place, and he communicated, and from telephone to we came to cordless phones, and then cordless phone to cell phone. And we had faxes where I would send a text message or a piece of paper to another person to read the text. Then cameras came digital cameras. Initially we used still and video cameras. TV was another form of mass communication. We have moved on now the digital platforms. I don't think I need to explain any of this. You all know this. I'll read the list just for the benefit of this, that we are using cell phones, we are using satellite phones, sat phones as we call them, emails as through which we all, every day in, day out, we use instant messages we have been using. Sir was talking about Twitter, was talking about LinkedIn, WhatsApp, Telegram, Facebook Messenger as they have it now. We can share scanned documents, digital photography, videography, then live FaceTime, online sessions. I would like to reiterate what right now we are doing. We are just having a video call that can handle many people. So that's what we are doing right now. Finally, you all know that our TVs have gone smart and we have a UHD, Wi-Fi technology entering into TVs. I think we all know that. I need not explain it further. Communication has gone through a big change. We all know that. Now, when communication changed and communication was basic to human life, all sectors of life saw a shift, major shift. From banking, we have now moved to online banking. We have automatic teller machines. We have now specialized printing machines that can print our, you know what, your passbook or something, if at all you want to keep a physical passbook. Otherwise, you can easily maintain a digital passbook. We all know that. But we know that it has all the changes in banking that we have seen. We have seen changes in business, changes in trading, changing in stock market, changes in retail market. How we used to go to markets I still remember how when I used to buy a book on Nayi Sadak and the whole day I would have to roam, if that is the right word to use, to find one book. I still remember I was looking for a book by A.C. Bradley, Shakespearean Tragedy, and right from morning in that Daryaganj road I was roaming, and perhaps around 5 o'clock I could trace a book. That book that I was looking for. Today, if I want that book, maybe it would want, even the ordering the book won't take 3 minutes, and finally the book would be with me maximum in 3 days, even in at a place, remote place like Sirsa. So that's what digitalization has done. Similarly with transportation, I hope you all remember our forefathers used to walk, and then from walk we had wheels like cycle and carriages run by human beings. And from there, we had, from bicycles, we had motorcycles and scooters and motor cars. And now, perhaps, we have a Google Map guided driverless taxi that you just enter in and you key in your address and it takes you there. Similarly, our governance, our TDS system that trickles down to the commonest of common, the lowest strata of the human citizen, and the biggest person, the first citizen of the nation, President of India, to the lowest strata of society, the poorest of poor. Now we have a UPI-based KYC. Perhaps we have the biggest digital database in form of our Aadhaar cards. Similarly, mass communication systems like TV, radio have changed. Now we have FM broadcasting text-to-speech and speech-to-text. You just keep speaking on, and it will type your document. That's happening every day, day in, day out, it is happening. You all are able to hear to your Amazon Kindle, that you put it to speech and it reads the book. You can decide which voice you want. You can decide at which speed you want. So it has moved on. Similarly, our communication from, say, written communication from typewriter, we used to have written letters, typed letters, and now we have moved to 3D printing, where perhaps we will be able to print even human organs maybe 10 years, 20 years, or God knows, it might already be in some Chinese lab. Since Chinese, they are not sharing everything with humanity, only the leakage comes to us. So who knows, it might be already existing somewhere, we only don't know. So these are the sectors and the shifts. I've counted only some. There are hundreds, thousands more. Maybe it might be coming to your mind 10 other things that have gone through the shift. It might not be in my list, but I know they are there. So when everything was changing, when the basic human communication was changing from hieroglyphs to we came to oral traditions, from oral traditions we came to the textual. Even text is a word that has new meaning in digital age. Perhaps when I was a student, we used to understand a text only a written text, or maybe maximum in a recorded lecture. But now it is basically human ecology, communication has changed, the whole environment has changed, whole communication has gone through the change, society has changed. Since society has changed, society's human aspirations, our demographies, our livelihood, how we want to earn and spend, how we want to live our lives, our health, our physique, our physical life, our domestic life, every aspect of human life has changed. So knowledge or education, which actually targets the questions of human life, since life has changed, society has changed, the questions have changed. Now, education that answers that questions, it has to find, or it is already finding, or it may have already found certain pedagogy that can answer those questions. So my basic assumption is, what I want to say is that when the world we live in has been digitalized, so expecting that it will remain same is not common sense. It is basically common sense that education, since the life has changed, since the society has changed, since the human questions have changed, pedagogy would change, education would change, the whole ecology of education would change, and it is already changing. You must have seen some changes. you will see some changes from analog world to the maximum of digital world. We are in between. We, as I said, that maybe 1st May 2020, let us say, let us assume, let us agree, or at least my perception is that is 50-50. We are half analog, half digital. So is education. It has certain changes. It has already seen certain changes. It is seeing certain changes. If you think, if you are allow me to use the terminology, to all of those who understand cricket better, maybe you can say that when test match was boring in 1972-73, Gary Becker and his team came with one day matches, and we all know that how one day match changed the cricket from white men white dressed gentleman game to a colorful masala cricket it became. And what I feel that total digitalization would be a 2020, maybe an IPL, maybe a 10-10 match where every ball will count. So it will be a digital match, 120 balls, 180 runs kind of thing. That's where we are moving, if you allow me that terminology. I think we have moved on from test. We are somewhere, let us say, 1983 or 1987, India won the World Cup, and it further popularized the one-day cricket, and one-day cricket came to the South Asian subcontinent, and it changed cricket itself from the Mecca of MCG or from the Mecca of Lords. It came to Bourbon Stadium, or for that matter, Eden Gardens, and it changed. And now we are going to, perhaps, if you allow me that terminology, it is somewhere around 2001 NatWest series when India trumped England. It's somewhere around Corona would be placed in time map, if you allow me that time map. But education is changing. And here I'll stop here. This is the first part of my presentation where I was talking about what digitalization is and how it has changed. What kind of history it has. And now we move to specifically to our area of education, that there are lot of changes that education has seen. I would like to make it very clear to all of you before we move on that there is a lot of emphasis on delivery. We emphasize a lot that delivery is important. We are talking every day when you talk of education and digitalization, we only talk of online classroom. We only talk of how to deliver a session on WhatsApp. We only talk of how can I use a Facebook session? How can I use a Facebook Live? So I'm sorry, this technology-driven discussions have been only about the delivery of education. Maybe some of the experts sitting here in this session dealing with educational technology would agree with me that digitalization in education is not about how you make an online class. I'm sorry, the general perception about digitalization and education is that it is about online class. At least my session is not about online class. I will have only one slide about online classroom, or that too, only the 33% of it. I'll be talking about how digital economy, how change in digital life have brought changes in education. So initially speaking, in the analog world, or if you allow me that time frame up to 1990s, we had a theory-centered education. Education was more about teaching theories to our students. Now we are more about application. We want to teach the student the use of it. So in theory-based issues, we talked about, let's have a very common example. We used to teach templates to our students in theory-centered classroom. Let us say if we were teaching him an application, a sick leave, we would give him a template and the student would cram the template, and at times he would even fail to innovate with that template. I hope all of you have heard that wonderful joke about a student he had crammed a My Best Friend joke. And his teacher told him that you can innovate, you cram 4 or 5 essays, and if you get those essays, very good. If you don't get those, then you can very easily innovate. So you can easily shift the cramp part to the one asked in it. So the student got a question, in his question paper, he got an essay on father. And the template in his mind was my best friend. And he innovated the template to something like, I have many fathers and Ramlal is my favorite father. And he ended with something like, a father in need is a father indeed. So that was how theory-centered teaching was basically a template-centered teaching. Today, now we have moved on to an application-centered teaching where if you are teaching a student, let us say you are teaching him an email, there are already sections like he will have to write a subject line to whom he is sending an email that has to be written with commas. New email addresses can be added. He can be adding. He can be sending some blank carbon copies, and he can be sending carbon copies, and he can attach an attachment, and he has to write a text, and how he has to write a text, how it will start from left, what is the text, and then there are now applications within applications which tell you whether your language is correct or not. I don't know how many of you use Jinjer or Grammarly or other applications which actually work in your mail as well. So that's where application-centered teaching is taking us. Even now, if now, maybe 10 years from now, a classroom will not be teaching a template of sick leave. It will be only giving a demo, an application-based demo of a sick leave. I'm taking a very simple example so that faculty-wise, we do not have an issue. We all can put it our own examples in it. And similarly, it was a degree-centered analog world, and education was degree-centered. It was important to say that what degree do you have? Maybe people were defined by their degrees. Even the Western world used to have their degrees written. So if I were to write my name, I would write it my name and then my degree. We have moved on from there. The digital world is not about that. The digital world would understand my knowledge with my skill set, what kind of skill set I have, what kind of skill set orientation I have, what font I have used in my mail, what color I have used, whether I have made a formal presentation with a colorful one or something like that. My degrees hardly matter. Maybe for 10 more years in India they would matter, but if you look at something like 2030, maybe I personally feel degrees won't matter. Similarly, learning was a process. Means you would take a 10 plus 2 plus 3 plus 2 plus what knows what, 6 maybe PhD years, and you are learning. It was a process. Now it is no more the case. Now it is more of an outcome based. Maybe up to 10th, 12th, it is well understood that we use it those as a basic education, but I think that we, from there, we will move on. Once a student has done his 12th or maybe graduation, then what skill set he knows? Maybe he can do a 6 months Microsoft certified program and he would be able to get a better job than he can get through a master's degree or something. So outcome is targeted now and learning is outcome based. Maybe my certificate, nobody would ask me to show my digital humanities certificate. They would expect me to show it in my presentation. If my presentation finally is able to tell you that I have learned something in digital humanities, that is more important than whether you happen to look at my certificate or not. So the analog approaches have moved on to digital approaches. But it has come with certain other things as well, which might be, these might be new for, especially for faculty of humanities and social sciences. That education was considered something serious, something sober, serene, studious. I'm sorry, we have moved on. In digital world, it is like a game. It is like a video game. We want to create graphics for our education. We want to make maybe a comic book kind of book that tells us, rather than an autobiography, our student in digital life would like to see a video or maybe a graphical book. So analog system, analog world, which was more in universal nature, that one model fits all kind of thing, that 10 plus 2 plus 3 plus masters plus maybe MPhil and then PhD. Now this postmodern change is, is it has gone to splinters. Once you have done your 12th, sky is the limit. Horizon is the splinter. Whatever field you want to go in, just do a course, just do an online program, just do a course, maybe a physical classroom course, and then you draw your line and you master some profession in your life. It is a personalized approach now, and it is going to be an interdisciplinary approach, a multidisciplinary approach. If I get more time, maybe I'll come to this interdisciplinary, multidisciplinary approach and collaborative approaches more towards the end of this session, but I think I'm running short of my time. I should have finished up to by 12:30. I should have finished it. I'm already at 12:37, so I'm leaving certain parts. Even assessment, what you call exam, we used to have summative assessment. Hope most of you, most of us, have studied in yearly exam. I used to write 4 exam a year, 4 courses in a year. I totally wrote 8 papers in MA English. Today, a student that I teach studies, what's it, 20, 22 papers, courses, 4 credit each, sometimes 25, with some open elective. And the exams are not writing once in the whole year. It is a formative assessment. Most of us, our ministry has, so I expect most of us have moved on to formative assessment. Already we have come to this semester system. Then CBCS approach already has some internal assessment, some external semester end examination. And it is unfolding. It is coming up. In next 5-7 years, we will be having more quizzes, more internal assessment, more written assignments. And maybe the end term exam would have less than 50% weighted. We have already moved towards it. We are very fast moving. As I said, we are in the blended approach. We will move on. We will reach there. Now let's try to understand that how is a digital teacher evolved? Most of us are here teacher or students or research scholars who are in the process of becoming teachers, we all would understand the first part that I'm saying, that earlier a teacher skill set, when somebody was being interviewed, these were the 4 things we used to judge our students or our prospective candidates. First, of course, was degree. I'm sorry, I don't have degree in my list. So the first thing was language. The degree, sorry, that's not available. But in the interview, of course, some people who have cut the basic cutoff, only then once you are invited to the interview, these are the 4 things that we use to judge in an interview. That can a teacher use language? Does he have domain knowledge? Suppose I'm being interviewed for a teacher in the English department. So do I know what poetry is? Do I know who are the major poets? Or if I'm being interviewed for a department of education, do I know what education technology is? Do I know what pedagogy is? What are the different curriculum aspects? How to build a curriculum? How to build assessment? So this was what was being tested at the time of interview. Then am I a pleasing personality? Do I have an interpersonal behavior? Do I know the basic etiquettes of entering in a room, talking to the panel? Do I shout, talk loud? Do I shout when I talk? Or am I not even audible to my classroom? Do I speak too slow for a classroom to understand me? So these things were checked. My classroom management was checked. Am I able to handle a class? People were given this approach to ask whether can you handle a class? Sometimes even such models were used that, okay, assume that here is a class and you have to teach a class. And let us say you have to teach this class, what you are doing right now. So please assume that you are teaching Robert Frost, you are teaching bending walls, and teach us, considering our class. So that's how people were interviewed, most of us, those who have been interviewed prior to 2010, maybe today, I'm not sure. I'm sorry, I don't sit on the other side of the table too much. So that's how we judge people. Now language, I'm sorry, what has shifted is that now language has a new subset, and it's a digital latent knowledge that I must know. I must know what is being, how would I teach? So maybe if I go to an interview today, Vice Chancellor sir would ask me, will you be able to teach online? Maybe 2 years down the line, thanks to Corona, thanks to this condition, COVID condition, online delivery would be perhaps the most important aspect. Maybe I'll be asked, maybe in my CV I'll be asked whether you can deliver a MOOC, massive online course. Can I deliver that? Can I design that? Can I develop that? Can I deliver that? That's going to be to be a new skill set. That's where all of you who are research scholars still and going to enter education or teaching line, please mark my words here. That's how it is going to be. Now, communication as a teacher has a new subset. And that new subset is, are you able to form Google groups? For that matter, are you able to handle communication, let us say, on WhatsApp? In last 10, 15, 20 days, I have taught, say, around 5, 7, 10 sessions on WhatsApp through podcasting, using my voice, sending 3 minutes audio clips to my students, then asking them to send questions either in audio clips or in question. Professor Pant from IIT Kanpur has developed a wonderful learning management system that revolves around WhatsApp. And if you just go to Google, Baba, you just write down WhatsApp, Professor Pant learning management system, maybe you will be surprised that it's already something worked upon. So you have to develop it. You cannot say that I am a PhD in English, I am a net GRF, and I have passed your written test, and nobody taught me online teaching. Vice chancellors or people sitting on panel say that nor were we, but we are doing it, handling it. So accept it or not, it is part of your skill set that is expected today. If you are not in it, you are out of it. Teacher is still, now look, there is a bit, at times I find it very interesting, the discussion that teacher is a role model, teacher is a nation builder. So I, though it might be in lighter vein only, I always say, so teacher is responsible for what the nation has become today. And yes, we are. You agree to it or not? Yes, we are. We are responsible for the kind of nation we have made. There has been a serious downfall in our delivery, in our curriculum, in our own morality ethics delivery. So I don't know whether ethics will be able to deliver, we will be able to deliver ethics and morality through online teaching or not. That is still being talked of. I do not know much about it. I'm sorry, I'm not commenting on it. But teacher is still the nation builder. Teacher is still the torch bearer in the society. Question, friends, is this, are you able to get into this new avatar? Because here is something that we need to ponder upon, that we are still the role model and there is no privacy or personal space left because they are on your WhatsApp. If I post a status that is very personal to me, my students are looking at it. So I have to be very wary of my online activity. Sir was saying that he is active on Facebook. I initially did not go to Facebook, and for that matter and for that record, I'm not on Facebook even today just because of this matter. Because I personally feel that it was an infringement on my privacy. But then, that was then. Now perhaps I don't have a choice. I have to go there. And friends, of course, even the digital life will trouble us more because now everything has been turned into digits. How it changed in our life? API was the first digitization, if not digitalization, of measurement of teaching quality. And then you will be filling up your NIRF data, All India Higher Education data, your Google Forms, and even your audit objections. If for the last 5 years we have been evolving for FMS, I hope soon it is done. So you will be even completing your audit objections even on your digital platform. So you should be ready for that. If you are not, then you are losing it. Then you are behind it. So in your skill set, for your professional life, you have to be prepared for it. So what more changes? Like, these are certain points that I would like to discuss, bring to your knowledge. I hope most of you know it, so I'll just go through it. I would only elaborate where I feel that elaboration is needed. I'll just go through the list. I'm sorry, I'm just reading what you are looking at, but maybe sometimes that helps. I would like to explain wherever I feel that I have something more to contribute. Textbook is no more sacrosanct. It is no more a religious thing that you cannot touch. So it is not, I hope I'm using correct books. It is not R.S. Gupta's physics that is important now. Or it is not Yashwant Kanetkar's Let Us See. Or for that matter, I don't know who are others. Or for that matter, A.C. Bradley talking on Shakespeare tragedy. Textbooks are no more sacrosanct. I still remember people used to say that if Shakespeare were to write IAS exam and he did not read A.C. Bradley, perhaps he would fail. So that's a wonderful situation here. Now we have practically all A.C. Bradleys in all fields. Now a YouTube session may be much more important, maybe much more explanative, maybe much more authoritative than the textbook that you have. For example, we the Department of English created a textbook on Merchant of Venice, on Kanthapura, the novel by Raja Rao. But I think that more than those texts now, what is more important is that a student can go and watch videos or online lectures on it, and text would be explained to it. So even if he's reading the text, if he's reading it on an Amazon Paperwhite, he can touch the text if he comes across an important tough word, and he need not go to the dictionary now. He just touch the word and the dictionary, and there also he has option of dictionaries. So text is no more a limited sacrosanct thing. Friends, teaching, as you know, was already not easy, not one of the easiest of jobs. Of course, bureaucracy would not like to agree with me because it suits them not to agree with it. Teaching was never easy because it was not a single set of intelligence. Your behavior was checked, your pedagogy was checked, your focus was checked. So you are handling a class. Once it happened with me, I was having a wonderful class, but people outside the classroom were not comfortable with this class. So even I had to handle them and then inside the class. And teaching in Tagore Bhavan in English department gallery, it's not about how you handle the class or how you deliver the class, but how you handle the gallery. That is important. But that was already difficult. And now you have more things in it. You have to do multitasking. Right now I am looking at my desktop screen. I have to handle that. I have to see the button that I go to the I give it a video presentation. My presentation is running in one window. And I can take a glass of water and drink. It has gone multifaceted. It has become multitasking. It has further complicated because every time you are competing with Google Baba in your classroom, you are teaching a student that a retreat of Caporetto, you are teaching a farewell to arms to your class, and you are telling them that retreat of Caporetto happened in 1917. And suddenly your class student says, sir, yes, sir, it happened on 13th of July 1917 on the border of Belgium and Italy, and 70 people were killed in it. Because Google has, the student has a key to all information. So you have to be always and always competing with Google Baba. If suddenly you say that it happened in 1918, maybe one of your students would, at least I was that kind of student, so I know that, would stand up and say, sir, I think it was in 1917, at least Google tells me this. So you have to be that much correct with your information. Especially with digital information, especially with confirmable information. Maybe with opinions you can be different, but you have to be very clear. Now, dictionary reference books, authorized texts are outdated. I told you, you don't need a dictionary. If you are reading from your mobile phone, maybe dictionary.com would help. Maybe if your application, if you are reading it on Kindle, on .mobi or .ajw format, maybe you touch it and the dictionary meaning would pop up. So they are no more needed now. They do exist. And they would further exist. But they do not exist the way they used to exist in the analog world. Now text is no more limited to written word. You can suddenly have somebody, if Hemingway's voice was recorded before he died, computer can easily simulate it, and you can listen to a novel written by Hemingway in Hemingway's voice. A.R. Rahman has done it. Nusrat Fateh Ali Khan died, and even then he has composed certain songs in the voice of Nusrat Fateh Ali Khan just by voice simulation. That's happening. That's going to happen. So text is no more a written word, friends. The textual boundaries have gone big. Pedagogy now places learning at the center. Teacher is at the periphery. Earlier, teacher used to be center. If the teacher has not come to the class won't happen. If the teacher does not tell you to read the text, if the teacher does not explain the poem did not exist. Now it is no more the case. Now it is learner-centric. Now a teacher is no more a sage on the stage, but is a facilitator, aid on the side, he is. And I'm sorry, friends, we have lost that authority, the aura of authority. Google Baba has that authority now. When you say something and Google says something else, your student would like to believe Google Baba. It is misused as well. I would like to comment here, because Google Boolean algorithm can be handled and mishandled. In last 4-5 years, it has been mishandled like anything. Things have been used to manipulate data. People have manipulated data. They searched 5 lakh times in a day the best leader in the world, and a particular person was shown by Google. The worst leader in the world, and a particular person was seen. Google algorithm is user interface specific. If you search it, the more you search it, the more you will find it. If all of us write down in our Google search box the best university in the world, Chaudhary Devi Lal University, and all of us run this search 500 times a day, within 30 days, Chaudhary Devi Lal University, if somebody searches the best university in the world, Chaudhary Devi Lal University might figure in first 5 universities in the Google search. The algorithm has that side of it. Maybe I'm not that technically qualified to speak very specific about it, but that is possible and that is happening. Now lecturing is outdated. You see, you cannot just go to the class and lecture. It has to be interactive. It has to be multifaceted. Flip places. Now the teacher is not doing the lecturing. Teacher is only recording videos. Classroom has flipped. The whole gamut of flipped classroom is being taught. For the sake of time, I'm sorry, I'll just run through it. Now only assessment is your regime, but is that your regime? No, even we are moving forward on that. Now, this is part of, you have to develop content. Text is no more the only content that will handle the class. You should be able to handle Google. You should be able to handle Boolean searches. You should be able to handle advanced searches. You should be able to know and understand and use YouTube. I don't know how many of us have YouTube channel. Maybe you can search mine. Just write PSCDLU on YouTube, search my channel. Maybe you will find something interesting. It used to be very personal, but now I have moved on. I am trying to give it a professional look as well. Maybe you'll find something interesting in it. You know my mail ID. I am Pankaj Sharma, CDLU. So PSCDLU, just go and search. Maybe you'll find something interesting. Open educational resources are your Encyclopedia Britannica today. That's where you need to find things. Your job is about, you have to locate the data. It might be a visual data, textual data, image, multimedia, lecture, whatever it is. You have to locate it. You have to parse it. You have to clean it in a way. You have to edit in a way that it becomes useful to you. And you have to curate. Curating is new word. I hope you can see on the right side, I've shown three things: creativity, CCP, and curation. CCP, I hope you all understand, because we have been doing it wonderfully well, but copy-paste. And that's why plagiarism is an important aspect. I'm sorry, in my today's presentation, I'm not handling it, but always at the back of your mind, you have to remember that wherever you use somebody else's idea, thought, image, you have to cite it. You cannot just cut, copy, paste, and go ahead with it. Either you are creative or you are good with your citation. Even in curation, you have to cite it. So you have to cite, you have to find podcasted videos, creating quizzes. Kahoot is one application where people create so wonderful quizzes. And quizzes are going to be our assessment. You have to develop Google Forms. Maybe at the end of today's session, I'll give you a form. Or if you want, I can give it to you right now. Just a minute. Just bear it with me for a minute. I'm going to give you a feedback form. Maybe you take your time and you can you use it. Take your time. You can do it after the session. I've just given it for the matter of record for you. So you have to do the assessment, self-assessment, feedback. So the form that I've shared with you is basically a standard feedback form that I have. I want your opinion about how I can improve this. So I have sent a form to you. Make use of that. So delivery in digital age, we all know that even the classroom has changed. Smart boards, flip boards, and brainstorming, they have taken place. Professor Dharmani, if you could tell me, can I finish it by 1:15 or 1:30? What time you would like me to finish? Please unmute your mic and then tell me.
We have time up to 1:30, so please leave at least 10 to 20 minutes for the presidential address. And
I hope to finish it at, say, let us say, between 1:15 to 1:20. So I have a lot of slides left, but I would like to run through it very fast. So delivery in the digital age, even the classroom has changed. If you think that it is the same classroom where Farag Gorakhpuri used to enter and read through his famous old book, that is no more there. Even your classrooms you already have in Chaudhary Devla University, in most of the classrooms, at least one classroom per faculty has a smart board. Start using it. Maybe you can use a lot of PG Paathshala or even NAPTEL programs have those wonderful content. You can start using it. Even that classroom has flipped. You can give certain documents, certain. You can share it on WhatsApp or give your students some material and ask them to read it at home and then come back in the class and then brainstorm it. You ask their opinions, bring a discussion, maybe on discussion forum you can use it, but even in the classroom. Of course, you have been hearing 100 things about online discovery, online teaching, platforms, performance, predicament. For the want of time, I'm sorry, I'll just run through it. I won't discuss it here. You all know it. MOOCs are future. Massive online learning courses, they are the future. There are specialized courses that are coming in, curated programs that are coming in, add-ons, open elective, open demand, app-based. They're just in things, and they are the in thing. I have done an EDX course. I have done a couple of more courses on WebEx. I have done a course on even on Zoom before it was banned, and I'm doing it on Google Meet. Right now, we are having a kind of session. So sessions, courses, short-term programs, even ARPIT, you know that, faculty development programs, that they are going to be running, they are going to run on online platforms. Finally, I'll just give 5 minutes to these three slides. As a teacher, what is expected of you? And as you see the last line here, the last line in red, the opinion is strictly mine. You are free to disagree, but I didn't have a framework. I searched it, neither UGC nor any other framework body in India has, till this point of time, created a framework what is expected of a teacher in a digital age. So this is personally mine. I may be wrong, I may be right, I might have diluted it, I might have created a stiff one, but that's how. Please place yourself where you are. Are you able to type on a QWERTY keypad? Do you use both hands when you do it? Do you understand what is UTF-8 format? At least in two languages can you type? Especially English is one. If you cannot do in second, it's okay, but at least in English, I'm sorry, not because I'm a teacher in English, I'm saying it, but since it is a global village and Corona will convert it further into a global village despite all social distancing things being talked of. But the matter of fact is that you must know how to type in English. You should be able to handle your keypad, a QWERTY keypad. If I find research scholars telling me, sir, wo typist ne galti kar di hogi, that's accepting that you have done a crime. If a research scholar is not typing his thesis, he's doing a crime, a culpable homicide kind of crime for research. Similarly, if you are writing your paper and somebody else is typing it, I'm sorry, friends, you are not doing something good. You need to type it yourself. You should be able to fill your own forms. You should be able to use computer. You should know what operating system you are using, whether you are using Windows or you are using which version of Windows, Windows 8 or 10, or whether you are using a Mac or an Apple operating system. Do you know what is the read-on memory in your system? What is its capacity? What does it work? What kind of capacity of RAM you have? Can you troubleshoot if your system hangs up? Can you correct it? Small things, can you handle it yourself? Do you know how to use internet? Can you connect to the internet, or you need somebody, your assistant, to connect it? Or you do not understand where are the problems in connecting it, what kind of different connections possible? Can you handle Wi-Fi, or is it a LAN connection, or what is a WAN, or what is a LAN and what is a Wi-Fi, and how the ecology is different? You should be able to understand. You should understand that if I'm using Google Meet, I'll be able to handle it better in Google Chrome, but it won't be good in if I'm using Internet Explorer or Opera or some other browser. And similarly, what is an application, especially in mobiles, application is seriously important. Do you understand what is an application, how it collects your information? There was a lot of hue and cry about Zoom, that Zoom actually goes through your whole system, whole laptop, and collects all the information inside it. Maybe if you have your salary account or your account information or your credit card information, it actually collects that and sells it outside. So that was the security threat. It was not a terrorist threat. It was a security threat for applications. So you should be able to understand these basic things. You should know how to use a search engine. If you know that which are the keywords that you have to search, you should be, even if you are teaching a class, you should be able to search something. Similarly, you should be able to understand advanced search, that if I want to find the latest thing, how to find it. If I want to find something in 1970s that happened in 1970s, how to control the time frame, how to control the advanced search about material that is available for everybody to use, or something that is copyrighted. So you should be able to do those advanced searches. You should be able to download, handle the download, like creating and managing files and folders. I hope these are normal things you all understand. You should be able to write and read and reply mails. So this is the basic. Next stage is, I think you all should be considered an efficient teacher. At least, I'm sorry, again, it's my opinion. I may be wrong, but there is no framework given by any agency in India. So I have to develop my own. I would consider you an efficient teacher. My opinion doesn't matter, friends. What I consider or not is not important. You have to have your own opinion. I'm sharing mine because I'm delivering this session. I'm not forcing it on anybody. That's your choice, friends. So I'll consider you an efficient teacher, not in computer science, not in electronics, not in mathematics, but in all three faculties, STEM faculty, science, technology, engineering, and management, mathematics, same with commerce and management, and same with social sciences, languages, humanities. Though, of course, if you are in library sciences, coefficient here would become basic, because library sciences in humanities, I think, are the most digitalized of sciences. So you should be able to create PDFs. You should be able to create PDFs, edit them, split them. How you can break 2 pages out of a book of 200 pages. It is a PDF, you just want to use 2 pages, maybe the forward you want to use. So how you can bring it out? How you can write it, mail, and how do you write mail merge? That to whom it should go, to whom it should not go, to whom it should go as a CC, to whom it should go as BCC, to whom it should just go, just the information that the mail has been sent. Who should be able to see the text as well? Who should be able to see the scanned documents as well? And how do you, if you can maintain a vacation tool on mail, that means you are an efficient teacher. Similarly, you should be able to use text files. You should know the text formats, how a Google format is different, a Google spreadsheet is different, a Google Doc is different, a Google slide is different from a PPT. How you can convert a PPT and use it as a Google slide, the way I'm doing it right now. Similarly, with your Excel files, how you can manipulate data. Can you put all your students in say, alphabetical order? Or if you have the age factor rate, could you put the whole university, whole faculty, or whole students, whole data set of students in terms of their age? So that's how you should be able to manipulate Excel sheets. You should be able to use image files, crop them, edit them, simulate them, make a video file from text files by using frame per second kind of metrics, using those things. Similarly, using video files, you should be able to create multimedia PPTs. Our teachers, they were never taught, not their fault. It has to be, I'm sorry friends, it might sound arrogant to you, but it has to be your personal effort. No institutional effort has ever taught using PPTs to teachers, at least in last 13 years in CDLU, nobody taught all the faculty members how they can make better PPTs, at least that what I know. But you have to know it on your own, and you have to use it. Unless you know it yourself and use it, I think you are in soup. This is the ultimate stage. If you can reach it here, at least from my framework, you are a proficient teacher. You are a teacher worthy to be in a department of a prestigious university. You should be able to use shortcuts while searching, typing, able to use tools of content creation and delivery. Like you can create a Moodle platform, you should be able to create Moodle. You should be able to create your own ID on Moodle, add students on it. I tried it last month. I could only even add my students, but there was no institutional support, so we couldn't handle it. But maybe future is coming. I'm very hopeful, optimistic. Honorable Vice Chancellor is also here. Professor Dipti Dharmani is also listening. Senior professors, professors in administration, dean directors are listening to it. So I hope soon we will have these platforms and we will be able to use them. But what's the benefit? Once we have the platform, are we able to deliver on them? I don't think there is going to be any hand-holding, anybody is going to teach us this, but we should be able to learn it on ourselves. We should be able to design, develop, and deliver MOOCs. That's future. Now your MOOC module has more API than your Scopus paper. So please have a look at it. That's your future API. Can you use web publishing like WordPress? Other possibilities where you can create your blogs, you can create your websites, where you can disseminate through various different platforms. Are you able to, as Vice Chancellor Sir was also talking about, are you able to write and use your blogs? You write a blog today and maybe 5 years down the line, you can use it as a content for your classroom teaching. Further moving on, can you use command line instructions? Are you able to manipulate data using different machine languages? Are you able to manipulate large texts? Are you able to search through them? For example, I'm giving an example from literature. Maybe some of you will be able to understand this. There are two major critics. I've been talking about A Farewell to Arms of Hemingway right from the morning. There are two major critics, Arliss Baker and Earl Robert. they have done a research. It took them maybe a couple of years to research that how many times autumn, mountain, plain, and rain, these four words occur in Hemingway's novel, A Farewell to Arms. And they have analyzed it. It is a matter of 2 minutes now. If you can handle the text as a large text, you do a control F search, put these words one by one, or maybe collectively, or maybe write a program to do it collectively. It will give you the count within a minute. So research has shifted, moved on. You have to be able to, you must learn to be able to manipulate large texts, data sets. And if you can have, you have to have your own website. The other day I was told that maybe you can have a website in 29 rupees. So have it. This is how the new game changers are going to change this world. I think 3 things you need to know. AI, that is artificial intelligence. ML, that is machine learning. And IoT, as is generally used, Internet of Things. I'm sorry, I have run almost out of my time, so I'll just run through it. Maybe you can use it. Maybe I'll share the PPT with all of you, and we can discuss it if you have issues here. These are the challenges that wait all of us, that how we develop the coming ecology, how AI is introduced into education, how the policy frameworks, like the framework I was talking about, UGC and other MHRD and other framework developing agencies need to understand that we have to bring in AI. And this is how I think that in next 5 years, this is at least my 5-year plan, that I am able to understand and handle all this, that I am able to handle what is known as artificial intelligence, what is known as machine language. I am able to develop a textbook into a graphic. I am able to develop a board into a teacher board. You all use it. You use Siri, you use Alexa, and they are bots created. Audio bots that use you use text-to-speech, or maybe using your own experience and searching through Google and other platforms, they bring out information. So you ask Siri, what is the temperature right now? It only searches in Google, it searches the time at this point of time, what is the temperature in Sirsa at your location, since you have shared the location, and it tells you it 35 degrees, 37, 38, whatever right now is the temperature. So that's how board works. Friends, knowledge is primary. Degree doesn't matter. Of course, for minimum eligibility, it does matter. But after that, what you have done, it's going to be matter. The biggest university is the one that will have the most powerful digital platform. I'll stop it here, not discuss it further. Libraries have shifted, have changed, have become different. They were physical infrastructures till 1990s. They become information centers from 1990 to 2010. They are now resource center in 2010 onwards. So all the universities that have wonderful resource centers in form of their libraries will be able to survive this onslaught of digitalization. Library buildings, university buildings, maybe 10 years, 15 years down the line, will become redundant. This is not what I'm saying, but there is a famous book called Fourth Educational Revolution that tells us this, that do not invest into buildings now, because buildings are not going to be important from by the time we reach 2030, because more important will be what kind of bandwidth you have, what kind of online presence you have. So either, friends, it is either a digital way or highway. These are certain things. I'll just take 2 minutes to go through it. All digital life is self-reflexive. I'm reminded of a wonderful share by Galip.
Pankaj, sorry.
Pankaj, 2 minutes, madam, please, 2 minutes. Just last, this is my last slide. The word is, वो पूछते हैं हमसे कि गालिब कौन है, कोई बताए उन्हें कि हम बताए क्या. But you go to Google and ask it, what is Google? Who is Google? When it was formed? It will tell you. So, all digital life is self-reflexive. It is, meta is the word. But you are placed in a C-graded city, in a third world,
You are the third, the last burden. Change will come the last to you. So till 2035, we are all safe, friends. Customer is the king, but data will do the Rajabhishek. Your student is the king, but between you and your student, there is something called data. And data, either you learn to manipulate or it will manipulate you. There is something important that Harvard, from Harvard to Naptali, it took one decade to for MOOC to move on. How long it takes to reach your student is a future thing. And friends, I'm sad to say, education is a business now. Whether it will remain a state-sponsored business or a private one, that has to be seen. And we have to be very cautious about the purest of pure. Thank you very much, friends, for your patience. Your feedback you can give through the form that I have posted in chat box, or you can write down a mail on my email. You have both the links here. I must have done certain stupid things in my presentation. I'm sorry for that. I apologize if I have done something wrong with that. I'm ready to handle your questions and feedback and responses. The session is over to Professor Dipti Dharmani. Thank you.